Good afternoon, everybody. Can you hear me well?
Yes.
All right. My name is Malik Glee. I am the Executive Director of Stable Arts, and thank you so very much for joining us this afternoon as we kick off the first DC presentation of the new Eagle Creek Saloon. Thank you. And I have to admit, I have to like catch my breath because this is a massive lift. And if I can say an anomaly, given the history of where the exhibition has traveled. At Stable, we are a very small team, so I want to give a major thanks to our board members, my team members who joined for this project, Adrian Loving, Jessica Woodson, Silky Sullivan, Joyce Milford, and all others who have touched the project with their encouragement, with their hand power, with their financial power. We're really thankful for our sponsors to make this happen. So I just want to say and express my gratitude before we get into the conversation today. But firstly, I'd like to introduce and have our guests introduce themselves. And I'll start with you, Rodney.
Hi, is the mic on all right? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, my name's Rodney Barnett, of course. I was born in West Medford, Massachusetts. Not a great thing, actually, if you hear me talk about it more. But I moved to California. I was drafted in the Army, spent 12 months in Vietnam, and eventually relocated to the Bay Area in San Francisco. And from then, I'll be talking about the whole process of doing that, so.
Excellent.
And I am Sadie Barnett. I am an artist born and raised in Oakland, and very excited to be in DC. A lot of my artwork has to do with my family and our, you know, shared and collective histories. This project is a little different in that it also involves all of y'all. And, you know, by being here and getting a drink at the bar and talking about this history and sharing it with your friends, you become a part of the project. And so I really want to thank all of y'all for being out here today. And just a few other quick shout outs and thank yous to my mom, Ellen, to Steven, who is not only my partner in life, but partner in art and fabricated this entire sculpture that has now been crisscrossing the country and living its own life. I also want to shout out my cousin, who is also from the West Coast, but is out here at Howard. We are very proud of you. Thanks for coming through. And there's just like friends from so many, you know, different walks of life. Christopher representing UC San Diego. Red, who is our star on bar at almost every other version of the project and gets to just be a chill, relaxed guest today. We're very happy to have you. And to Malik, like, it's just been so amazing collaborating with you. Malik mentioned that the process of, you know, organizing with the Stable team around the bar has really mirrored the ethos of the bar. They've been able to pull in, you know, connections and community and just Black folks uplifting each other and creating opportunities for each other. So really appreciate you, Jessica and Silky, you know, for making this all happen.
Thank you. And I learned a little bit earlier today your background in Massachusetts, Rodney. Can you share what brought you to San Francisco and maybe your initial thoughts once you got to California?
Okay, like I said earlier, I was born in Medford, Massachusetts. Actually, Medford has, especially West Medford, has a unique history. It's one of the oldest Black communities in the country. They were all right from Medford. So in 1700-something, there were Black people living in West Medford, actually freed and enslaved people. Medford had, there was a family in Medford who owned 60 enslaved people. There's still things there that remind you of that. There's a slave wall there, slave quarters, and so forth and so on in West Medford, in Medford, Massachusetts. I lived in a segregated community. We could only live on three streets in the city. The reason we were able to live there at all was because we lived right next to the Mystic River, in between the railroad tracks and the river. And every year the river would overflow. So the white people didn't want to live there, so we were at peace there. And we actually were a community. We never locked our doors. We created a community center. We had tennis courts. We had organizations. The young people had clubs that we belonged to. I guess nowadays they'd call them gangs, but we had social clubs that we belonged to. And we were harassed by the police. Before I was an adult, I was assaulted by the police a half a dozen times. Not only me, but my brothers and sisters and people in the community there. So eventually I got drafted into the Army, and all my family, my father was in World War I, I had brothers that was in Korean War and World War II and so forth and so on. So everybody participated in the draft when they were drafted. So when I got drafted, the war in Vietnam was just beginning, and it wasn't really widely known. But I talked to my family. I said, you know, I don't like the way we're treated, and I don't think I should go into the Army. So they said, well, just go. You know, you're drafted. It's 2 years. Before you know it, it will be over with. Unfortunately, I could talk all day about, so tell me when I'm talking too much. But anyhow, the more closer you got to danger, the more black and brown the Army became. When you got onto the front lines, you wouldn't know there were that many white people in the United States. I got wounded in Vietnam. A friend of mine with that same explosion got killed, and it was sad times. So actually, I came to California after my nephew, my sister's oldest son, got killed in Vietnam. So I came to go to a funeral of my nephew, and then I could see on TV that the LAPD were out of control. They were conducting military-style operations in the black community. They were killing young black men, shooting them down, going to black people's homes, and occupying pretty much the community. The way I talk about it is that if we did some of those things in Vietnam, it would be considered war crimes. So I winded up moving to California pretty permanently. And from then on, my brothers, there were 11 siblings in my family, everybody kind of pretty much moved out to California as well. So I got involved in an organization I thought would help to stop some of the repression, and that was the Black Panther Party. They had a 10-point program, and I said, well, this is wonderful. And I would help to implement those demands that were in the 10-point program, free breakfast programs, decent housing, education, free clinics, ambulance services, all the things that the community did not have, we were going to try to bring to the community. And it was very widely supported. I mean, I don't know how many people signed cards saying I'm a Panther member or not. I don't even remember that I did. But eventually, we had meetings in Compton, where I lived, and we had meetings in my brother's garage. And then it got to be so popular that we opened up an office in Compton. It was the ninth office in the Southern California area. Something happened during the course of, I was talking to ministers and to religious people, organizing and so forth, and things were going well. And then some strange things started happening. And, you know, I'll try to cut it a little short because there's a lot more to talk about. But I realized that the Panther office had been infiltrated, and there were provocateurs and agents that were trying to take over the leadership of the Panther office. And I was called into the office one day, and they told me, well, Rodney, you have to start implementing discipline to members in Compton that are coming late to meetings. And I said, well, what do you mean? I said, well, if members come late to meetings, we have these sticks, and you're going to beat them with these sticks. I said, you're crazy. What's the difference between us beating somebody and the police beating somebody? So they said, well, you either do it or you leave. So I said, well, then I'm out of here because that's crazy. And, you know, and from then on, I suspected that it was the party was taken over in L.A. by infiltrators and FBI agents and so forth. So they did a number on me. They got me fired from my job. At some point, I wanted to find out what files they may have had on me. My daughter, Ellen, my daughter's mother, we sat down and wrote demanding copies of my FBI files. Believe it or not, we got 500 pages after years of demanding these files and stuff. And there are things in there like, if Rodney Barnett doesn't change his mind, we'll kill him, and things like that. And at the same time, they were killing Panthers and so forth. At any rate, I'm going to try to move on to the next phase where actually I was out of the Panthers. My brother moved to California with his two kids and his wife, and I let them have my apartment. They had fired me from the post office on the grounds of something that the presidential order that they used to purge gay people out of government positions, and they used that to say I was unqualified. What they said was that conduct unbecoming of a government employee. I was cohabiting with a woman that I wasn't married to. So that's the basis of them terminating me. And I saw things like that in my file and so forth. So I moved to San Francisco. I've always been openly gay man, you know, and so I never, thank you so much, never hid that. My family, when I was 10 years old, they used to always ask me, oh, can you do the Eartha Kitt imitation? I said, Santa baby, anyhow, so I was still active when I was out of the Panthers. There was a war going on. I was participating in anti-war demonstrations, and there's all kinds of other issues. We had an elected official, first black official elected from the LA area, and one day we found out that the police were raiding the Panther office in South Central in Los Angeles, and there was a call for people to come there. So before the police could block off the streets, people showed up by the hundreds there. So the job of the police was to push us out into, so that they could conduct their assault against the office, against the people who were in the office. Turns out, there's a guy standing next to me. At that point, they were hiring cops from Mississippi and Alabama. Very racist, no black or brown cops at all. And then when the cops were pushing us back, this guy says, listen, I'm the representative elected in Sacramento for this area. And he said, nigger, I don't care who you are. And he punched him in the face. And so we all started running. They were after us. They wanted to hurt us. And people would take us into their homes and so forth and so on. And eventually I wound up, when I would come to anti-war demonstrations in San Francisco, the people there were so supportive, so against the war, that we would march down Market Street. They would open their windows, they'd play music, they had signs saying anti-war signs and so forth. I said, wow, this is a nice place. In LA, we would go to Orange County sometimes and people would yell out, go back to Africa. Mm-hmm. Anyhow, so I wound up going to San Francisco, and at that particular time, there was the gay area was in a place called Polk Street. They called it Polk Gulch. There were a few gay bars there, some up on Broadway and so forth. And that's where I began to realize that there's discrimination going on against black gay people in San Francisco. So they were asking us for 3 pieces of ID to get in a club. We had fights. We had picketing these different bars and stuff. And the reason I'm bringing that up, because that's history. I'm not trying to start no new crap or anything, but that's history. We need to know about that. And it could happen again, too. We need to know what we went through. Eventually, years later, I was able to open up my own bar. And so there was a white man who owned this bar before I did. He wasn't American, he was from Australia. And he said, Rodney, because I lived right around the corner from there. He said, I want to sell my barn to a black man. I said, oh, cool. You know, I didn't have any money. So I, you know, got my family, and all my family got involved in it. I have like four or five brothers that helped to rebuild the bar, to make it clean and livable, and so that we could be proud as black gay people. And we made sure everybody was welcome too. We had problems with the gay newspaper. They were warning white gay people, don't go there because it's dangerous, right? So anyhow, why don't I just stop and let me...
Well,
be careful with your questions.
Well, no, I appreciate the response and on learning all about what led to the new Eagle Creek Saloon. One question I'm thinking of is, how did your work with the Panther Party inform some of the ethos in this project, especially given the slogan, you know, at least what I understand to be the slogan, in that it was a friendly place, of, maybe I'm going to butcher it here, for every race,
exactly.
You know, making sure, and it was an inclusive space. But additionally, either you or Sadie have shared in conversation that it was somewhat of a community center that served liquor, that served drinks. So what were some of the other amenities and you know, just paint the picture for us. Like, how was the Eagle Creek Saloon, and how did you develop the audience and community there?
Okay.
So you want me to tell the slogan?
Yes, get it right, because I probably did it wrong.
A friendly place with a funky bass
for every race. Okay, that's easy enough. I got
and,
it.
And this is really typical of how the bar operated. I didn't create the slogan. The customers, or the patrons, or whatever you want to call them, they said, Rodney, we need a slogan for the bar. And we talked about it back and forth, and somebody came up, well, what about a friendly place with a funky bass for every race? Because they really talked about what we were all about. We weren't trying to make a segregated place. We wanted a place where everybody was welcome. We wanted to be friendly. We wanted to have good music. And that was perfect for us. And then there was an artist who designed the logo, the New Eagle Creek Saloon. That was a logo that they designed. There were different things that happened. The black people were never represented in the gay parades that they had been having for 20 years there. So they said, Rodney, we need a float in the next gay parade. I said, well, you know, I don't have money for no float. It's thousands of dollars. So they formed a committee, and they had fundraisers at the bar on like Sundays, and had beer bus where they sold beer for a dollar. And we eventually got enough money to have a float in the parade. There was a one person who was a tailor or seamstress or a gifted person in designing costumes, who made like at least a dozen costumes for everybody that was going to be on the float. And we looked really good. Sadie was in the float on top. She was 6 years old. And she still has that costume, too. So, you know, so we went on to the side street. We're on the side street, and they announced, okay, Eagle Creek Saloon. So you go on to Market Street, and we had cheers from the crowd. They were so happy to hear our music and to see us. Sadie can talk about the theme of the float and stuff. There's other stuff that we'd like to talk about, too. Well, okay. There were no black bartenders, no black DJs working in the bars. There were over 100 gay bars and restaurants at that time in San Francisco. I even joined what they call the Tavern Guild, which was a guild that was created to fight discrimination. They never invited me to any meetings, and not too long ago I looked at the list of bars and restaurants that they had, and Eagle Creek was not on that list. And so we trained people to work in a bar. We had 8 bartenders who never had an opportunity to work in all the other gay bars and so forth.
I mean, yeah, I guess just one thing I wanted to mention, just to kind of frame the context, you know, that my dad created the bar, and just to get, you know, the dates out there, the bar ran from 1990 to like the end of 1993. It was located on 1884 Market Street in San Francisco. And what I like you know, to point out in this situation is that it wasn't exactly that my dad like had a dream about, you know, being a business owner or an entrepreneur. It was really out of necessity because of the experiences that him and his friends were having, you know, in San Francisco, in a place that's supposed to be so welcoming. And, you know, here they are, they've all come together, they've got on their best outfits, are going out for a night, you know, together, and they're met with being asked for three forms of ID at a bar. You know, their dress code being policed, their dancing being policed, you know, being skipped over at the bar when you're waiting for a drink. And just to me, the idea of like, you know, meeting these indignities, like already you're gonna meet these indignities throughout your daily life, in your job, in the city, but to be met with that, like, you know, when you're off the clock and you're supposed to be celebrating yourself and each other, I think that was just such a, like, the final straw. So really that was why my dad opened this space, was because people didn't have anywhere to be together, to be fly and fabulous and comfortable together, you know, to celebrate Black holidays, to play Black music, to really just, you know, be together. And a big part of the reason I wanted to make a project that documented that was because of how influential it was and what an impact it had on my, you know, not only on my thinking and my upbringing, but so many people have told us, especially as we've kind of done this reunion tour, what the space meant to them. You know, people talk about coming out at that space, you know, being a little shy and nervous when they first started coming and then becoming proud. It was really important to my dad that the space itself had a lot of pride to it. So the first thing that he did was like knock out the front wall and put in a big window, so it wasn't like a dark, seedy place. It was a classy joint where you would be proud to be and proud to be seen. His brothers came and helped do like the electrical and a lot of you know, upgrades and repairs. You can see their photos in different, you know, places on the installation. So it was very much a family project, but just that idea that it was created out of necessity, I think that's what really kind of ties it to my father's political work, you know, throughout any different decade that you want to pick, was really about serving the people and responding to the needs of the people. And in this case, you know, what the people needed was a fabulous bar.
And let me kind of back up in time a little bit. When I did move to the Bay Area after I was out of the Panthers, the government, J. Edgar Hoover, they were after Angela Davis. They wanted her dead. They had her on the FBI's 10 most wanted list. Does everybody know who Angela Davis is? I hope so. Anyhow, actually, at that point, we started organizing, even before what I call, before Angela surrendered, we started organizing in her defense to demand that she have a fair trial, that she get out on bail and so forth and so on. And I can tell you that lots of gay people were involved in that support too. You know, we had fundraisers at different events in San Francisco. There was a Black restaurant called Connie's West Indian Restaurant, and we had slideshows and did presentations about political prisoners and Angela Davis being imprisoned and stuff like that. And eventually, where I was organizing was a little further up north, and we had such successful organization that Angela was brought to Marin County. I was living actually in Sonoma County. I was going to school up there, and we organized, and we had the biggest rallies and that the school ever had. And so when the trial got transferred to San Jose from Marin County, the committee, the National Committee to Free Angela Davis, they approached me and asked me if I would be willing to move to San Jose to continue with the organizing and so forth. I said, well, you know, I am willing to do that, but something you need to know is that I'm a gay man. And if that's a source of embarrassment or that the committee could be blackmailed, or you need to know that, because I'm not in the closet. So they said, hey, that's no problem. And actually, I spent a lot of my time talking about being gay to other members of the committee. And, you know, everybody knows the end of the story, that we were successful in winning Angela's freedom. And, you know, gay people had a lot to do with her being free. So that's part of the history that we love to talk about.
Thank you, Rodney. Sadie, as you were talking about the intention that Rodney had to make sure that the public could see into the Eagle Creek Saloon, that there were these, you know, windows so that people felt proud, I want to pivot a little bit more to this structure that we're sitting at and some of your choices to make it glittery, sparkly, this pink saturation. I've just been thinking pink all week because we're putting up lights, we're just making sure that we are creating this vibe. And if you could get us a little bit behind the choices that are mounted in this project.
Yeah, I mean, I think, one part of it came from a practical standpoint, which was that there weren't a lot of photos of exactly what my dad's bar looked like. Mm-hmm. And in a way, that was kind of a limitation. But then I thought, well, actually, it's really an opportunity to just dream and, you know, forget about being like a realistic portrayal, but can I just capture the ethos and the spirit of it? And in fact, can I do it in a way that's fully my aesthetic? Because I felt like the Eagle Creek really wants everyone to just do them. Like, whatever your, you know, best version of yourself is, that's what the Eagle Creek wants you to bring and you to be. You know, the Eagle Creek in the 90s and the Eagle Creek now. So I thought, let me just lean into my aesthetic and my voice as an author and make it look like, you know, Sadie dreaming about my dad's bar. And so that's why it features a lot of the materials that you'll see in my other artwork, like the metal flake objects that are painted by a car painter. You know, growing up on the West Coast, car culture was always a way that, you know, people kind of tell you about themselves, announce themselves in the world, and, you know, find like-minded people just through this, like, shine and this aesthetic, similar to, like, manicures and over-the-top jewelry. That's always been something I've just been interested in, the way that we kind of announce ourselves. So I wanted the bar to have that shine and to reflect back, you know, the beauty and kind of glittering, imagining, like, potential futures also. I feel like it kind of feels like a time machine in a way, because we're in the 90s, but we're also in this future that I'm imagining where we're so beyond, like, even, you know, needing as many, like, labels and explanations as we need now to protect ourselves. In the future, it's just like we can take it a little bit more for granted and create our own type of freedoms just by being ourselves. So, and then again, you know, I wanted to embed the history. So there's photos on the bar. I've got my Uncle Alvin, my Uncle Carl. We've got Sammy in that collage next to Malik. Sammy was really kind of one of the icons and characters of the bar. You know, we can share more stories as we're hanging out, drinking around the bar about Sammy. And I also wanted this, like, U-shape I found is so welcoming. At first, I wasn't sure, like, the first time we built this project at the lab in 2019 in San Francisco, we were like, okay, this is an amazing sculpture. And what are people gonna do with it? We're not sure. But as soon as people walked in, they sat down, they put their elbows on the bar, and it stopped being a sculpture, and it started being like a temple. It started being a place where something happens. And every institution that it goes to, it's a little bit different, but something always happens with the people that come together and the intention that folks bring into this space. You know, the intention of, like, learning about history, caring, but also, like, wanting to have fun and, you know, be playful and exist in the world that we have, even as we, like, wait for and fight for a better world. It doesn't mean that we're gonna stay home and just be sad about it all day. Like, this is our life. This is our one shot, you know, that we know of at a time. So it really is a call for this kind of rage and celebration and, like, righteous, fabulous, just, like, existence. Because I always saw that in my father and in my family, like, no one was waiting for the world to catch up with them and who they were and their beauty in order to just be, like, so fly. Like, who has time?
Thank you. Yeah.
Oh, right? But my dad's reminding me to talk about the mirrors, which I should mention. This is the only objects that we actually have from the original bar. And when I tell you this story, this is like the kind of magic and connection that continues to happen throughout this Eagle Creek revival, which is that another amazing black queer punk rock artist, writer, icon, Brontez Purnell, worked in the space after my dad's bar had closed. I forget, another organization was in there, Brontes was working there, and he heard about the history of the bar. And so when he stopped that gig, and I guess they were kind of clearing out the space, he saved the mirrors. And they were like, you know, these broken fragments. They used to be a whole wall of mirrors at the Eagle Creek, but he saved these fragments for over 20 years. And then when he found out that I was doing the project, you know, starting in 2019, he got in touch. He's really good friends with the director, Dina Beard, at the lab. And he was like, I have the mirrors from your father's bar. And he was like, could you please come get them? Because I've been, you know, storing them for 20 years. I mean, it's kind of a hard thing to, like, take care of. But to me, it was just wild that, like, the one thing that was saved, you know, saved by an artist, saved by Brontes, and was these mirrors, and just thinking of what they had seen, what they had reflected, you know, like people just checking themselves out, mm-hmm. you know, checking each other out. And so we built these purple plexiglass frames. We wanted them to still feel broken, but also special and like these treasures.
Let me tell you one story about the mirrors. I mean, to me, I can almost feel like I remember looking in, people looking in the mirrors as they came in to have drinks. But there was one guy, young guy, who would come in the bar. I don't think he even drank, but he would come in. He had a few books in his arms all the time, and he would look in the mirror all the time at himself, right? And so one day I said, so who are you? What do you do? He says, I'm a medical student. I said, okay, right, okay. Just looked all the time. But years later, I was in New York at Greenwich Village, and I was in a bar there, and somebody came rushing up to me from the other end of the bar. He says, Rodney, tell everybody I'm a doctor now.
That's so sweet.
So it was such a nice, it was worth him looking in the mirrors. But there's another story I want to tell about my brothers. Like I said, I was always out, and I'm not sure all my brothers, there was 9 boys in my family, two girls were the oldest. But, you know, they weren't involved in my personal gay life. I mean, when we had events, family parties and stuff, I would bring a boyfriend or whatever and so forth. But when 3 of my brothers came up to help rebuild the bar, we had family members who were giving us money to help keep the bar open. I mean, I could have bought a big fancy house in San Francisco with the money I spent, with the money my family spent on opening the bar and keeping the bar open for the years that it was open. But the great thing that happened was at least a couple of my brothers, they stayed there and helped to do other things in the bar. And they became good friends with a couple of other gay guys, right? And one of my brothers became drinking buddies with one guy, right? So the reward was that they really knew what your life was all about. No stereotype stuff or anything like that. They approved 100% of how we lived and so forth and understood. And it was great. So.
And if I may, as you talk about the family support and mounting the bar, I wonder, Sadie, how has it been for you, one, collaborating with your partner and creating the physical structure, but also with your father and creating the more intangible, like the programming, the conversations? How has this venture been for you and bringing your community into the project?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, working with family, it has its ups and downs. But it's one of those things where you just kind of know what you're supposed to do. It feels like an inheritance to me and like a responsibility to tell these stories. I've always looked at my family, even when I was like, you know, before I knew that I would be an artist as my job, I just was always like snapping photos at family functions or like wanting to like take notes and remember things. I just was one of those people that felt like, you know, as I say, sometimes I think it's some people's job to take care of the future, and it feels like for me, it's my job to take care of the past. I always just want to save these stories. And so I really wasn't so much that I make like a conscious choice, but I'm like, okay, this is what needs to get done. Mm-hmm. So let's just go ahead and do it. And it's, you know, I think it's a special element of it is that I feel like a lot of times, you know, in queer spaces, sometimes it's like a refuge from our family, and it's not always necessarily an intergenerational, you know, experience or spaces that we find ourselves in. And so to me, the fact that this is like a family project that's also, you know, a gay history is really important to me, that like those things are not, we're not forced to have those things separated, mm-hmm. you know, like that we can be like a family reunion as well as like a gay bar. And I think that intergenerational element of it is just really important. So like when we've done events in California, we've had former, we say members of the bar, because again, it was like a community center. We've had former members, you know, hanging out, and by the end of the night, it's like my friends and my dad's friends are best friends. And mm-hmm. I just really love that, like a longer lineage. And looking back, I think sometimes, you know, we feel like we have to invent our own space to be in, and sometimes we lose sight of what has been, you know, what's come before us and our queer history. And obviously it's important to kind of break the mold, shake the mold, do your own thing, create new language, but also I think we lose sometimes like a connection to our past and to what's come before us. So I think those are the elements that are kind of brought together in this project. And it's just one of those things, like to be honest, one of the reasons why I love like being in my studio and making art is because I can do it, you know, kind of safely and by myself. I listen to my podcast, I'm kind of an introvert. And then all of a sudden I find myself creating this monster project that involves like production and people and spontaneous things and unpredictable, you know. And it's just, it is what it is. I've had to like dig deep down in myself and ask like, how can I grow and how can I fill the space that I'm given and that this project needs and wants. And that has just kind of felt like both a challenge and a calling. And sometimes I'm like, oh my God, why? And then this like magic happens and people tell me like about the connections that it's made for them or what it means to them. And then it's all worth it. And you do it again and you just kind of respond to what the art and the story needs and wants.
Yeah. Let me tell a couple of more stories about what happened in the bar itself. Like Sadie said, and it's like it was like a community center. We were political. We fought, you know, for gay rights. When Harvey Milk and the mayor of San Francisco, Moscone, were murdered by this white cop in San Francisco, and when they found him not guilty for eating Twinkies, we all participated in the protest that they had. We went down to City Hall protesting just like black people do. And it was lots of gay people and black people and other citizens of San Francisco. And we, what they call riot, but we protested. We turned over police cars. And it was all of us. It wasn't this segregated, okay, you black people, you can do here, and we're white guys, we'll do here. And so we participated. We were productive citizens of that county. We were lawyers and newspaper reporters, doctors, and everything you can think of. We contributed to the betterment of that society as a whole. And for us to have to go through showing three pieces of ID to get in the club, we just refused to go there. I mean, we understand we're not wanted, we're not welcome. But one of our members of the bar filed a lawsuit against these bars and restaurants carding three pieces of ID, and we were successful in getting the city of San Francisco to pass an ordinance saying that no bar or restaurant in San Francisco can ask for more than one ID for people to get in. And it was one of our members who filed a lawsuit against that happening. And we supported and had fundraisers for AIDS. Politicians would come in the bar. We were instrumental in getting a lesbian woman elected, the first lesbian woman elected to the San Francisco Board of Supervisors. Her name was Roberta Achtenberg. She actually went on to work in the Clinton administration. So we did everything. It wasn't just a bar where you go in, have drinks, listen to music, and go home. We did everything. We fought supported AIDS. We were the first bar, the only bar out of 100 gay bars in San Francisco where we had a program in the bar where interactive video program where members could come in, sit down, and look at this video and learn about safe sex and learn about AIDS. We were the only bar. They brought that into our establishment, and you know, we were proud. We had a proud history there.
Yeah, it was like a video game console that you could play this like choose your own adventure, and we have like an advertisement for it documented in the zine. There's like this booklet that I made with a lot of the, you know, few archival remnants, like newspaper clippings and, you know, show tickets and some photographs from the bar. So if you're able to get a zine, you know, my hope is that that can travel in a way that not everybody who can necessarily come to the bar, but that the little book can like, you know, circulate all throughout the country and the world, and that more and more people maybe run across it and see it and say, oh wait, the Eagle Creek, I was there. You know, we've actually been able to connect with a lot more people who were at the bar. Mm-hmm. Even like at SF MoMA at the last event, we met somebody, you know, not for the first time, but since 1990, who had been at the bar, who read about the revival in the newspaper and came to the project. So hoping that all these stories seep in, you know, where they need to go. And ultimately, my dream would be that someone would come out and say that they have photographs from the bar. Still waiting on that dream to come true, but the stories are good too.
Talk about the DJ.
When we talk about Black?
Yes.
So, okay, here's another little story, and pretty soon we also we'll get back to drinking and dancing. We hope that y'all can hang out for the afternoon and, you know, keep having these conversations. But I guess to start with, like, when I was first going out to parties, I used to go to parties that this DJ called Black used to do, and actually still does some of those parties. And they like still had my number in their phone, but what they didn't know was that I was Rodney Barnett's daughter. So this was probably only a month and a half ago. I called up Black because I had heard that one of her first DJ gigs was at my dad's bar. So I called up Black and like, hey, what's up, Sadie? It's been a while. How you doing? I'm like, I'm good. I'm working on this project about my dad's bar. It was the Eagle Creek. And Black was like, what? That is your dad? And like, I really wish I had recorded this conversation because Black was just could not believe that that was my dad. And she was like, that was the first person that let me play records. You know, I used to hang out at the bar and the other DJ was out of town. I was like, Rodney, you know, can you let me play some records? And the way Black tells it, you kind of looked around the bar, you're like, should we give her a chance? and like that yes that you gave Black the opportunity to start DJing like led to a 30-year career. She has mentored like so many of the DJs, especially, you know, women-identified DJs that are DJing in the Bay now. And like, I used to go to her parties, and that was like the most kind of comfortable place that I felt, you know, coming into my own existence and my own expression. And so I'm thinking to myself, like, if my dad hadn't given her the chance to do those parties, I might not have had the parties to go to. Mm-hmm. And so it's really not like abstract, like, oh, you know, our queer history. It's like literally, it's like a genealogy that you can trace, that one thing leads to another. And so we were able to have her come and be on a panel at SF MoMA and then DJ the party. And, you know, these are the kind of things where it just must be some kind of magic that is, you know, fueling this project and this revival, you know, from then to now, because that just kind of exploded my little heart.
Okay, we're probably gonna...
we're going to get into libation and dancing and drinking
but
being in the ethos, yeah. But I wanted to ask you too, what does it mean? We are one, I want to acknowledge, in Black Gay Pride Weekend in D.C., Memorial Day weekend, and wondering what D.C. means to you both. You know, why is this an attractive and exciting city to base the Eagle Creek Saloon? I can share as someone from Prince George's County from D.C., but I have my out-of-towners. I'm curious to know your relationship and interest in having it here.
I'm so glad you asked that question because I wanted to talk about that. D.C. You know what? The first time, being from Massachusetts, the first time I went down south to Alabama, that's where my father originally was from, when we were flying over the land, I looked out of the window and I said, wow, my people cut down those trees for the plantations there. And my people are buried all over that place. And just, this was my first time really being in D.C., except for I was on a bus ride. I never got off the bus. But this is my first time, and I had that same kind of feeling. I said, this, look at this. D.C. is historical. Our people have contributed so much to the District of Columbia, Washington, D.C. And somebody asked me, well, what monument do you want to see? I said, I want to see Howard University.
Okay.
And, you know, I just want to thank you guys, really, from the bottom of my heart. This is it for me, to be invited to be here, to talk about the history of the bar and everything, and to be in the District of Columbia and to have that feeling. You know, people who live here, you may kind of take it for granted, but somebody like me, when I walk out there, just envision that we were here, we built this place, we contributed to this place. Back in the 1800s, we were running things in the Senate and the, you know, and everything. Anyhow, it's a historical place, and I'm so proud to be here. And I want to clarify just one other issue, too. When we bring out this history about discrimination, that does not mean we're not going to fight like hell for gay liberation, for the LGBT community and stuff. Even though we were marginalized by white gay men, they brought their racism with them from the states where they came from and so forth. But that's not going to change our position that we need to be equal, be recognized in this society for what we are. And thank God we're doing such a good job of making that known right now. This is going to be some tough times for us too, for all of us. So anyhow, could I just add one more little story? I wanted to, one of the things, one of the fundraisers that we had back in the 70s to free Angela Davis, it was a gay event, very popular and successful fundraiser. And they played this song. You don't have to play it. I was talking to the DJ about playing it. You want to try to play that? Okay. It was a song by Duke Ellington. And Duke Ellington, he was born in D.C. Did you know that? And so he was very popular throughout the country and other parts of the world. And I think when he made this song, he got blacklisted because he was bragging about the contributions that black people made to the society and stuff. So DJ, can you just play that little part of that?
My people.
Yes.
My people. Singing, dancing, praying, thinking, talking about freedom, working, building America into the most powerful nation in the world. Sugar, indigo, iron, coal, peanuts, steel, railroad, you name it. The foundation of the United States rests on the sweat of my people. And in addition to working and sweating, don't ever forget that my people fought and died in every war. Every enemy of the USA has had to face my people on the front line. Yes, and when Teddy Roosevelt led his Rough Riders up San Juan Hill in the Spanish-American War, for the first time, my people returned home decorated heroes.
Thank you so much. Now, there's one other song I want to try to move into the next phase of the thing, and that is, besides the Eagle Creek in San Francisco, there is a church, and it's a famous church, at least to people in California, called Glide Memorial. I don't know if anybody here has ever heard of it, But it was a safe place for gay people and black people to go to worship and to do everything else. It was a safe place. Can you cue up that song? So anyhow, put it down a little bit lower. Yeah, so one of the things that happened at the Eagle Creek was that when Glide Memorial, they had a beautiful choir. And so when choir practice was over, some of the choir members would come into the bar and have drinks after choir rehearsal. And one day, I asked one of the guys that was in the choir, I said, do you think I could maybe try out for the choir? And he says, let me hear you sing a little tune or something. So I won't try to repeat that, but, I did. I sang a little bit, and then he says, I don't think you'll make it. And so what I wanted to do now is to get people in the mood so we can, turn that up. We played this song in the bar. If you recognize it, it's from the Color Purple movie. It was such a beautiful scene. And I want everybody kind of put your hands together for this the beat. And the tempo builds up a little bit. Yes. Come on, put the hands together. Yes. Peace, Lord. Speak, Lord. Yeah.
Yes, get it.
Speak, Lord. Speak to me. I should have joined the choir, I think.
And another thing we just want to say is that y'all have to be regulars, so come back for all the events, support all the amazing film screenings, podcasts, dance performances.
Yes, we're open for 7 weeks, so I think this is the time where we're going to transition, and we're going to be in the vibe of the new Eagle Creek Saloon. This is a community space, so as my community tonight, please bear with us as we clear your seats so that we can dance. Don't be shy. Don't be pretentious. This is DC. I know that's the kind of ilk, but tonight we're going to give what's supposed to be gave, and we're going to dance and have fun.
Turn it up. Yeah. Let's go. Turn up the music. Come on, everybody. Get up and come on. Hey! Yeah.